Don't believe the
hype. Hi, everybody. This is Denise Rojas of Green Power Science, and it has been a very long time since I've done some solar cooking videos. To get the ball rolling, I'm going to be flash cooking two eggs using the power of the sun and this Fennel lens.
The Greeks used to sort of talk about the sky being this dome, and then beyond the dome the gods lived, and they would be all sat around this big hearth.
Okay, guys, it's very important, and when you're cooking with your lens, do not put the focal point in direct contact with your food or you're gonna burn it. I was able to cook two eggs using the power of the sun and this Fennel lens in less than a minute. I think that's awesome.
Yeah.
me is the sun, a thermonuclear reaction that radiates energy to Earth via photons. On a clear and sunny day, the sun's power output is approximately 1.3 thousand watts per square meter. So what we have here is called a Fresnel lens. Not a Fresnel lens, a Fresnel lens. And this is just like any normal lens, except it's compressed. It's been telescoped down so that it functions the same as a normal lens, only it takes up a lot less space and material.
It is super impractical to use a spherical lens to focus a significant amount of power, because it would have to be huge.
This is the problem that the Fresnel lens solves for us. We can take a convex lens, like that of a magnifier, and telescope it down, you know, like a pirate spyglass, into a lens that takes up less material but still has the same effect on light rays. This flat sheet of plastic consists of hundreds of concentric rings that are each a small cross-section of a sphere. This one's dimensions are approximately 4 by 3 feet, and its focal length is approximately 20 inches away from the sheet. Assuming 1.3 kilowatts per square meter as an input, the rough estimate for the output would be 450,000 watts at the focal point. I must hear you saying, but Dayton, I clicked on this video to watch things mindlessly burn.
I just want to watch the world burn.
Alright, fine. Let's just burn stuff.
Alright, fine. Let's just burn stuff.
This is aerogel, the world's lightest, that is least dense solid. This piece has a mass of just 1.22 grams. That is only a few times the mass of the same volume of air, which kind of makes sense because it is 99.8% air. In fact, some aerogels are so light that if you removed all the air from them, they would be less dense than air. I have long been fascinated by aerogel, so I actually flew out to Aerogel Technologies in Boston to find out, why was aerogel invented? How is it made? Why is it such a good thermal insulator? And what is it used for? Okay, we are going to try an experiment to demonstrate the insulating power of aerogel. So over here we have two setups, one with a glass petri dish, the other one with aerogel on top. Both are made of silica, but with very different physical structures. We're gonna see how long it takes to melt these chocolate bunnies with a Bunsen burner. Now to have a look at this experiment, we have a Fleur T1020, which can see temperatures up to 2,000 degrees Celsius.
That's pretty hot.
Yeah, you can see that. The glass is getting really hot already. And after just a minute?
It's starting to smoke.
Oh, okay.
It's definitely melting and smoking. Oh yeah, here we go. I would say that that's phasing.
We've got a liquid chocolate situation. We have some smoking bunny. Over here, the bunny is actually sort of melting over, and look, it's sort of tilting to the side.
Right. I think we're
going to
call that out.
What is that?
Oh, onto you.
Not only did the bunny melt quickly, the petri dish cracked under the thermal expansion. So now let's try the aerogel. It is getting pretty hot, as you can see through the thermal camera. But coming up on 3 minutes, there's still no sign of melted chocolate. So we're gonna pull out a thermocouple and just check the temperature underneath the bunny, like underneath the aerogel, and see what the flame temperature is. You can kind of see that the parts of the bunny are getting hot, but it's not the bottom of the bunny, it's all the around the bunny.
Exactly, that convective heat is moving up and around the aerogel.
So you can see the thing is getting red hot. And by 4 minutes, the bunny's looking a little soft. Well,
pretty good though, considering how easy it is to melt chocolate.
Can I put my finger here? Be careful. Not that it's hot, it's that it's blue.
Right.
But yeah, totally cool to touch, right? It is just warm to the touch.
Actually, right here on the table, I have some examples of some silica gel.
Silica gels.
If you look at aerogel on a light background, it's almost impossible to see because it is pretty transparent. But if you look at it on a dark background, then you can see that it has a slight bluish color. And it's bluish for the same reason that the sky is blue. Because all those tiny little nanoscale structures, they scatter the light according to Rayleigh scattering. And the intensity of light scattered is proportional to 1/4 wavelength to the power of 4, which means it scatters shorter wavelengths like blue much more than it scatters yellow or red.
And for that reason, aerogel looks opaque in the ultraviolet and transparent in the infrared.
Now, what do you think this would look like if I held it up to the blue sky? What do you think we would see? Would it look ultra blue? No, it looks yellow. And that's because the aerogel is actually scattering out that blue light, and so what passes through and makes it to our eyes is the longer wavelengths like the yellows and oranges. It's basically the same effect as looking at a sunset. When you see the yellows and oranges of a sunset, it's because the blue light has already been scattered out by the atmosphere the light had to pass through before it reached your eyes. So effectively, looking at aerogel against blue sky is like looking at a portable sunset.
The nanoscale pores of the aerogel are also what makes it such a good thermal insulator.
That's awesome. Does that look hot?
It's definitely hot.
You might think that because aerogel is largely comprised of air, like 99% air, that it has the same thermal properties as air. But that is not correct. It's actually a better insulator than air is.
That's because the width of the pores is smaller than the distance air molecules travel on average before colliding with something, their so-called mean free path. Hence, it's really difficult for the hot, fast-moving air molecules below the aerogel to diffuse through it and transfer heat to the top of the aerogel. This is called the Knudsen effect.
It is so weird because, you know, you don't expect something that's transparent to block the heat that well, but this really does.
And that's why NASA used aerogel.
That's why NASA used aerogel
insulation on the Sojourner rover, Spirit and Opportunity, the Curiosity rover, and they plan to use it on future missions to.
And they plan to use it on future missions to
Mars. Why does it need insulation?
The electronics, because they don't want the electronics to get cold during the cold nights on Mars.
NASA has also put aerogel to more exotic uses, notably to catch dust from a comet as part of the Stardust mission.
So the particles were traveling about 6 kilometers per second relative to the aerogel. So when they hit the aerogel, because the aerogel is a very low density material, very, very porous material, the particles actually enter the aerogel, and as they travel through the aerogel, they basically break apart the network that makes up the aerogel, and they lose energy in the process and eventually come to a stop. This is good for capturing particles because if a particle like that were to hit a solid surface, then it just stops, you know, immediately.
And just vaporizes.
And vaporizes.
So should we expect to see aerogel in our everyday lives anytime soon?
One of my running jokes is when they build skyscrapers in Antarctica, they'll use aerogel as thermal insulation.
One of my running jokes.
Why do you say that?
Well, because then they'll really care about how thermal efficient it is, because it'd be so cold there.
Because then they'll really care about that.
this American space plane has been in orbit for 700 days and no one knows why. Talking about the X-37B, this mysterious little spacecraft that's not really that big, that looks like a mini version of the space shuttle, has now once again been orbiting the Earth for almost 2 straight years, and nobody seems to know why. So, and you know, that's a question I have myself. What is this little machine? And what is it carrying? It's supposedly carrying some sort of a payload. Nobody really knows what it is, or at least nobody in the public. I don't know, it's just an interesting story. It's always interesting to talk about this and speculate on what it may or may not be watching up there in space. But anyway, it's approaching a new milestone, almost 2 straight years orbiting the Earth, and once again, nobody seems to know why. In this video, I've got some new sky phenomena. I've also got a video here from Toronto of something that they didn't know what was going on in the sky. Back on August 10th, this was yesterday, Francesca noticed some sort of an orb going over the Toronto area. It wasn't a Chinese lantern. They know what those look like. This was actually moving much too fast to be a Chinese lantern. It wasn't blinking, wasn't an airplane, it made no noise, it wasn't a helicopter, didn't look like any type of a drone because it was more of a round light. So, don't know what we've got going on here. It's just another one of those videos that was just too interesting not to share. They saw it, had a chance to get their phone out and take a video recording of this object as it flew by. And like I said, it was moving by at a pretty good clip. Made no noise, and it looked like it was round. So, some sort of an orb over Toronto, Ontario, on August the 10th of 2019. Thanks for sharing, Francesca. Greatly appreciated. I've also got another strange object in the sky. This was sent in from Tawanda, New York. And this was noticed by Blood Wolf 89. And there it is. And it kind of reminded me of the light from Ontario. That's why I shared it in this video. Once again, dated August 10th of 2019. Not so sure it's not the same light. I don't know. But August 10th, some sort of a strange orb was seen in Ontario, Toronto, Ontario, and here in New York. So it could have possibly been the same one. Zoom in really, really tight. And what I was doing was looking for any type of possible features and did not see anything at all. So, two round orbs, one over New York, one over Toronto, both on August the 10th. New Sky Phenomenon have many new photos at the Sky Phenomenon Photo Gallery, Yucca Valley, California, sent in by Michael. This is very interesting with regard to these triangles or squares up in the sky. I guess they would be more of a square or a diamond-shaped craft, some sort of an object. Maybe it's some sort of a weird reflection. Don't know. Never really seen anything quite like it. This is an absolutely beautiful, it's either a sunrise or a sunset, from Haifa, Israel, sent in by Revival Thomas. Beautiful photograph. Thank you for sharing. Once again, that's from Israel. Or Orem, Utah, sent in by Laren C. See that big, round-looking disc cloud in the sky. Denver, Colorado, the Mattis Cloud, sent in by John. Usually this is following a hailstorm or some sort of a thunderstorm. Here's another example. This was sent in today by Peter from Las Vegas. This vehicle is pointing to the northeast, and the sun, you can see, is just slightly to the left of northeast, according to the compass in his car. And he noticed it as he was driving. That's why he stopped and took a picture of it. The sun looked just a little far northeast than it normally does. So another good observation, and more people are noticing the sun being in a different location at sunrise and sunset.
Feel so good to get it right.
So we have a comet and we have an asteroid. A meteor is when a meteoroid enters Earth's atmosphere. So a meteoroid, if you've got comet, asteroid, a meteoroid, is a piece of one of these that broke up. So it's either a piece of an asteroid that broke up from a collision or other frictional force, or it's the debris left over from a comet as it passed by the sun. This meteoroid is in orbit around the sun. It's bigger than a grain of sand, smaller than an asteroid. When that piece of material enters Earth's atmosphere, we call it a meteor. So we've got a network in my head. So we've got comet and asteroid, which can cause meteoroids, which are pieces of debris that break off from their parent body. And then when it enters Earth's atmosphere, we call it a meteor. We see the bright streaks through our atmosphere because that debris is burning up, friction and pressure, chemical interactions. Another interruption, because I've been told that we are seeing the meteor. So our studio is rewinding.
even see about me down there.
Last century we had two massive world wars, three if you count the Cold War. I think it's unlikely that we will never have another world war again. It probably will be at some point.
Or if we have another one, it'll be the last.
Yeah, it just could be radioactive rolling. You know, this has been our pattern in the past.
But there's a lot more that must happen beyond this in order for humanity to become a spacefaring civilization, ultimately a multi-planet species. The most important thing is for the preservation and extension of consciousness. I'm actually fairly optimistic about the future of Earth, so I don't want to sort of people to have the wrong impression that I think we're all about to die. I think things will most likely be okay for a long time on Earth. But not for sure, but most likely. Where are the aliens? Maybe they're among us, I don't know. Some people think I'm an alien. Not true. I mean, if there are super intelligent aliens out there, they're probably already observing us.
What specifically do you believe that they don't?
The biggest issue I see with so-called AI experts is that they think they know more than they do. And they think they're smarter than they actually are. In general, we are all much dumber than we think we are, by a lot. This tends to plague smart people. They're defining themselves by their intelligence, and they don't like the idea that a machine can be way smarter than them, so they discount the idea, which is fundamentally important. It's the wishful thinking kind of situation.
If you consider two futures, one where we are forever confined to Earth until eventually something terrible happens, or another future where we are out there on many planets, maybe even going beyond the solar system. I think that second version is incredibly exciting and inspiring, and there need to be reasons to get up in the morning. You know, life can't just be about solving problems.
Everybody's watching up for a brand new love. Everybody's true. Everybody's watching up for a brand new love.
This will enable the creation of a lunar base. And it's 2017. I mean, we should have a lunar base by now. What the hell's going on?
To be clear, I don't want to die on Mars. If you're going to pick some place to die, then why not Mars? And if I do die on Mars, I just don't want it to be on impact.
There's likely to be another Dark Ages, which it seems, my guess is there probably will be at some point. I'm not predicting that we're about to enter the Dark Ages, but that there's some probability that we will, particularly if there's a Third World War.
In 2024, we want to try to fly four ships, then build up the base, starting
Build up the base, starting
a starts with one ship, then multiple ships, then start building out the city, then making the city bigger.
We want to make sure that there's enough of a seed of human civilization somewhere else to bring civilization back and perhaps shorten the length of the Dark Ages. It's important to get a self-sustaining base, ideally on Mars, because Mars is far enough away from Earth that a war on Earth, the Mars base might survive. It's more likely to survive than a moon base. But I think a moon base and a Mars base that could perhaps help regenerate life back here on Earth would be really important, and to get that done before a possible World War III. Everybody's watching up for a brand new love. Everybody's true. Everybody's watching up for a brand new love. AI, and it scares the hell out of me. is capable of vastly more than almost anyone knows. And the rate of improvement is exponential.
You see where things are going with virtual reality? If you extrapolate that out into the future, then eventually those games will be indistinguishable from reality. They'll be so realistic, you will not be able to tell the difference between that game and the reality as we know it. How do we know that that didn't happen in the past, and that we're not in one of those games ourselves?
So there's one thing I know about life. One thing I know about life is a guarantee. So there's one thing I know about life. One thing I know about life is a guarantee. As much as you like to be in your comfort zone, as much as you like to be stable, as much as you like to control your environment, the reality is everything changes, right? Listen to me. I can feel it. I can sense it. If you fall on your back, you can look up. And if you can look up, you can get up. So forget about your past, what happened in your past, and make the rest of your life the best of your life.
House music. first time on that house, it was a moonlit night. It was destined to be, it was love at first sight. First time I met House, I was lost in a space, you see. I came there alone, but she made me feel right at home. First time I met House, she was deeper than deep. I felt a chill down my spine, from my head to my feet. First time I met House, it was like a symphony of life. And she took my breath away, and she did it all night. First time I met House, she didn't even know my name, but she was my doctor love, and she cured my every pain. First time I met House, I knew our love would last forever, because that night she blew my mind. It was a sign from the divine. I met House, I didn't know quite what to do. I'd wake up in a cold, hot sweat, wondering was it true? Was my mind playing tricks on me? Did my heart and my ears deceive? Or was it just a lovely dream I had one summer's eve? First time I met House, I promised I'd leave her for no other. Even though I knew she had a million lovers just like me. Embraced her songs and melodies, forever dictating my Saturday nights and Sunday afternoons. I guess I'll be a fool for as long as she wants.